And oh, Ashley. Oh, that's better.
Hello.
Ashley, hi.
Hello.
Hi there. I don't think I've met you before, Ashley. Have we?
Yeah.
Have we met before?
No.
Oh,
I'm a
okay.
new one.
New student. Thank you so much for coming to my class. You're very welcome. My name is Greg, and I live in London, in England. So my accent is very English, I think, as opposed to an American accent, which you sometimes might hear, which is more like there, like you might hear a voice like there, but mine's not. Mine's very English.
Yes.
I've lived
Please.
in England all my life, and I live in London now. So Ashley, tell me about yourself. Where do you live?
I live in Taiwan, New Taipei City.
Oh, near Taipei. Okay, cool, excellent. And why have you come to study with ABC? What's your reason?
I want to go back to school, study, and take my kids to study
Oh,
together.
great. Oh, excellent, excellent. That's good. Your English sounds good. I have to say, I
Thank
think,
you.
yeah, I can understand you clearly, and your voice is very good. So great. So thank you. Thank you. I look forward to telling you about things.
Thank
And now
you.
I must speak to Sunny. Hi, Sunny. How are you? Oh, you're a bit quiet. I can't hear you. Are you on mute? Yes, better. Yeah, I can't hear you. How are you?
Bad.
Oh, why? Tell me. Tell Greg. I'll tell you, Ashley, in our class, we always talk a bit at the beginning. So, you know, it's a good space to share
Wow.
how we are feeling. And I believe in being honest, you know. No one's perfect all the time. Well, I can tell you today, I have a slightly bad stomach. I think I ate something bad yesterday. So if I suddenly run from my computer, you'll know. But more importantly, Sunny, tell me, why are you bad? What's happened?
I got a bad grade,
Oh, that's. In which subject?
Earth science.
Oh no. Oh, your earth science. Oh, and you are prepared for that. Oh,
Yes.
that's a shame. Why do you think it happened?
I don't know, but because today we have a exam for the end of the semester, but I think I put a lot of effort on earth science,
Oh.
but I think not only my grade is bad, but I still feel a little sad because
Yeah, because you made an effort. You know, it's not like you did not try. You were trying to be great, and it didn't work. I mean, in life that happens. You know, sometimes we can really work hard at things and they don't work. But I tell you, this is a very small, very minute thing. Now it's important. In 6 months, it won't be so important. And in 1 year, it won't be important. And in 10 years, you won't even remember. So now you feel sad about it, which is good. It's okay because it's a real emotion. But you know, things change. You know, I think. Do you think that's true, Ashley?
Yes, I think that's true. Times goes by.
Yeah, exactly. That's a good expression. Time goes by and things change in our lives. And so it's sad because you made a big effort to do well. Will your teachers tell you what happened with your exam? Will they explain, do you think? that you about your grade?
No, because we just done this test today, so.
Oh, okay. Maybe in a few weeks they can tell you what the situation is. I mean, sometimes it can be that not understanding the question can make a difference. I do that. If I read something very quickly, sometimes you don't get the whole. It was a great word, actually. I'll put it in. Oh, sorry, I'll share my screen. I won't put it in the chat. I'll share my screen. I was just looking for something, some information about something we're going to talk about, which isn't this. The gist. Can you both see my screen?
Yes.
Yeah, great. There's a great word, gist. It's sort of like understanding a small part. The gist, we say the gist of something. It's a common word we use in speech in English. And it means to understand part of something. And sometimes if you read something quickly, you understand the wrong part of the question. I mean, I'm trying to think, or even an understanding of a word. Well, I'll tell you the funniest, I know I put this before, two words that look very similar in English. If you write them, but you forget one letter, especially this happens in texting, the word friends, which you all know, I'm sure, and the word fiends. Can you see? They look almost the same, but they mean very different things. Fiends are like devilish people. So you could almost, you might accidentally text someone and say, oh, have you got good friends? But you might write, have you got good fiends? You know, it'd be very, very easy to make mistakes with things. So maybe Sunny, it was the gist of something that went wrong in the question, and you might have answered more one part of the question and missed the big part, or, you know, many things can happen. But don't worry about it. I mean, I'll stop sharing for a minute. It's life. Things happen. We trip up. We fail. We get up again. It's how it is, you know. I mean, things go wrong in my life all the time, you know. And you just have to sort of like have some humor. You know the word humor? Actually, that would be good. Can you spell, well, just let me just get that up. Ashley, can you spell humor for me?
Yes, H-U-M-O-R.
Yes, well, yeah, except usually we put a U, O-U-R. Did you say O-U-R?
No, I only say O-R.
Yeah, we don't really write that in English. Well, in English, in UK English, I mean, we tend to write it with a U. In America, that sometimes, they don't use the U. And I noticed the other day, for instance, in America, I saw this is the word blonde, the blonde hair, except in English, we tend to write blonde with an E on the end in England. So you sometimes find different spelling depending on where you are. I mean, because of the internet and the internet being quite American, often the spelling is wrong, I think, for me, you know. Yeah, I also work for an American company. Hi, Zoe.
Hi.
Hi there. I work for an American company where often, like for instance, the season before winter, you know, we have spring and summer. Do you know the two different words for the next season after summer? The English word and the American word. Does anyone know? Zoe, do you know the English word for the season after summer when all the leaves start to fall?
Autumn.
Yes, yes, well done. Well done, Sunny. Also, I put that on another line. Autumn. Yeah, autumn is the word we use for the season in England, autumn. I mean, it's a beautiful song called Autumn Leaves, actually, I should play you, if I spelt it right. Autumn Leaves. But does anyone know the word that American uses for autumn? It, weirdly, I think it relates to the word leaves. Do you know what they call it? Who, what did you say, sorry? Someone said it. Someone said it. Fall, yes, well done, Sunny. Fall. I think they say that word because of leaves falling. I don't know the reason, but we don't really say fall in England. But funnily enough, because I work for an American company in my other life, I have to write fall now, because if I write autumn, some people just don't get it. So I have to write the fall season. Really annoys me, actually, because I want to write autumn season. So that's the only, you know, we have different words in English and American quite often. So Zoe, how are you today, Zoe?
Not bad.
Oh, okay. What have you been doing today?
Nothing, just work.
Working, okay. Yeah. And what work have you been doing today? No worries. Maybe put it in the translation. Do a translation in chat, and then do a quick translation, and then come back to me. And Ashley, I didn't ask you, how is your day today?
I have a happy day.
Oh, good. Oh, good. What did you do today?
We just finished a dinner with my family.
Oh, lovely. Oh, that's lovely. And yeah. Did you have special food?
We eat a soup. A chicken soup.
Chicken soup. Soup. Yes, yeah, soup. It's a, be careful how you say that, because you, that's the word, chicken soup. But you were saying, actually, soap, which wouldn't taste so good, I think. Chicken soap wouldn't be so good.
Yes.
I wouldn't want to use chicken soap to wash my face. I don't think it's good. It sounds good, chicken soup. It's very good for you, chicken soup. Very good. So Zoe, any idea what you're doing today in English? What have you been working?
As usual.
Just as usual. Yeah. Okay. Studying. Yeah. Studying, yeah, as well. Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, good. Okay. Well, first of all, I think we're going to do Wordle because it's good. I'm going to get Wordle up. This is a thing I started doing recently, Ashley, with everyone. It's quite interesting. It's a sort of bit of a word quiz. I don't know if you know this. It's actually American, but it was created by an Englishman, and he sold the rights to it to the New York Times. So what we have to do, and actually Sunny's not here today, Sally's not here today. She's really good at it, Sally, I have to say. She's good. She's definitely as good as me. But what we have to do is think of a word that's five letters. Any word that's five letters. Now, if we get the word, we have five goes to get it. If we get a letter in the right place, it goes green. If it's a right letter in the wrong place, it goes yellow. And if it's the wrong letter, it just goes gray. So just so we can start, and I won't ask you first, Ashley, I'll ask Sunny first. Sunny, give me a five-letter English word. Any word you like.
Enter.
Oh, sorry. I have to click on the thing. Also. Enter. That's a good word. And you'll see what happens, Ash. Can you see my screen, Ashley?
Yes.
Oh, great. You'll see when I click this. Oh, well done. Well done. Oh, so as you can see, Ashley, we've got two letters which are right.
Yes.
But they're in the wrong place at the moment. The wrong place. Also, there's no letter E in it. So we have to think of words that contain TR, but not with E. So we've got to think of so can you think of another word? Well, Ashley can go next. Another word that's got T and R in it. Five letters. There's lots of, you know, we might have an A in it. It might have an O in it. Might have a U in it, an I in it as the vowels. Any ideas? No worries if you can't. Shall I go on to Zoe while you're thinking?
Tears
is good. Tears, no, it doesn't have an E. That's a great word, yeah. Though. Tears. Do you mean like T-I-E or T-A-R-S? Yeah, tears. It's a really good word. We can still put it in. It might help us, but it's not going to be right because it doesn't have an E. Doesn't have it. So maybe if you can think of another one. Ashley, any ideas? Maybe
water.
With an O. Which, sorry, what was that?
Water.
Water's good, yeah, but it's got an E. Water's got an E. So let me think. And also I was thinking of a word, a letter with, I think you can repeat a letter. So shall I do one? Trout. Do you know what a trout is? It's a fish. It's a sort of a fish in the river. Well, shall I? Zoe, do you want to have another go before I do trout? Because the R and T might be at the beginning or in the middle. Or Sunny, do you want to have another go?
Trail.
What was that? Sorry, I didn't hear you.
Trail.
Tray. T-R. Train, did you say? Train. Yeah, but unfortunately, we've got an N there, so it can't be an N. But I tell you, if we put a D, maybe try a D. Trade. See if that... Sometimes if they don't like the spelling of the word, it won't work. But let's try this. No, it doesn't like trade. Well, I'll tell you what we can do. I'll tell you what we can do. Put this, hang on. Track, you know, to go along on a track. Let's see what happens with track. Oh, we've got another letter. So we've got C, R, and T, but they're all in the wrong place. So any that, so it doesn't start with T and R. T's not, now you see, if you look at this, it gives a bit hard to do in your mind. T can't be there. It could be there, or it could be there, or it could be there. R can't be there or there. But if you think about it, you can't start a word, an English word, with R and T. It doesn't make sense. There's no words with R and T. So I think the R and T are down this end. And if you think about it, I can't think of a word that ends with C-R-T. So I think the C's got to be closer. I mean, but there's no A. There's no A. So I was going to say actor. But sometimes it can help you. I can tell you, sometimes it can help you to put a word in which is wrong, because then it will find a place for another letter, you know. So, Zoe, any ideas?
Trade.
And it doesn't work. To be honest, I do know what this word is. It's not a difficult word, but it's getting to it. It's getting to the word. It's difficult. We've got to think of other vowels, like no A. There's no A and there's no E. So either an I, a U, or an O. Ashley, any ideas?
No.
Oh, okay. Well, let's just put in, I know it's not the right word. I'm just thinking if this will help. Actor, you know, someone who's an actor. I know it's not quite right because it's got an A in it, but it might help us. Actor. Let's have a look. Oh. Now, basically, we've almost got it. It's got four letters. So we have to try and arrange those letters and put in another letter, and we've got the word. So can anyone see it? Sunny, can you see it? We've got four letters. So it's got an O. I think, Zoe, you're getting there. And I think, Ashley, your son wants to help as well, which is good. That's okay. Yes, he can join in. It's not a problem.
He wants to join.
Yeah, if he can think of the word. So we've got four letters. We've got four letters. C, T, O, and R. Now, I'll give you a clue. I think it starts with C. It does start with C. In fact, I know it starts with C. So can you think of a letter, a word that's got starts with C and has got O-R-T in it?
Court.
Did you say court, Ashley? Let's have a look. C-O-R. Okay, let's have a look. Yay! Well done, Ashley. That's excellent. Well done. You got it right, and it's the first time you played it. That's really good.
Oh, I'm lucky. Really good.
Yeah, no, you did it by you did it by logic and reasoning. You what you did is I should put the word out actually in translation. Hang on. You did it by logic. You know, reasoning and deduction. They're three great words, because what you were doing was you were thinking, no, because I could see you were writing things down, which is very good. So you were thinking, no, that letter can't be there. That, you know, I sometimes do that when I do that. I write the word and I think, no, what words? Because when I'm looking on the screen, I can't always see it in my head. But if I write it with a pen, it's quite good. So I always like to try and do Wordle with everyone when we're here, because it's a good brain test, which is great. It's a good brain test, but it's also fun. And also, because you're doing it in another language, I have to tell you, you're all brilliant. You're all very, very good. I couldn't do it in another language, definitely. So well done. That's excellent. Okay. So we're going to talk, and the main subject today is we're going to talk about English castles. I'll put that in the thing, English castles. So what do you think when I say the word English castles, what do you think in your mind of English? What anything that comes to mind, any word that comes to mind when you think of a castle? Anyone? Zoe, go first. Any word?
Have empire.
Empire. Yeah, that's an interesting word. Empire. It's a good word as well. Empire.
Vampire.
Is that right? Did you say
vampire?
Oh, vampire. I thought you said empire. Yeah. Vampire. Well, yes, you're sort of right. You're sort of right, a vampire. But funnily enough, the most famous vampire didn't live in an English castle. He lived in a Romanian castle. And does anyone know the name of the most famous vampire? I think you said it. I think you said it there, Sunny. Dracula.
Yeah.
Dracula. And did you know, though, that Dracula was written by the novel, the story was written by an English writer. An English writer, and his name was Bram Stoker. He wrote. He wrote Dracula. Yeah. In the 19th century. Yeah, he wrote. Actually, what I should do is there was a very good television drama of Dracula a few years ago. And it was one of the best ones I've ever seen. And so I should try, if I can find the trailer in a short while before we watch the video on castles, I'll show it to you because it's very good. So, Sunny, what word, can you think of any words when you think of castles, English castles or castles? What word do you think of when you think of castles? What comes into your head? Who lives in a castle, for instance? Not me. I don't live in a castle. Who usually lives in a castle?
King.
King. Yeah. Good. King and the other, who's his wife? Ashley, who is the wife of the king?
Queen.
Queen, yeah, well done. King and queen. Though sometimes, I don't know if you know this in England, if you have a queen, you don't always have a king. Because if she's queen by herself, her husband is not king. He's actually called, strangely, the prince consort. In the 19th century, when we had Queen Victoria, who lived a long time, her husband was called Prince Albert, not King Albert, Prince Albert, and he was known as the prince consort. So that's the married partner, the consort of the queen. Whereas if you have a king, like now we have a king, his wife is actually called Queen Camilla. I mean, there is actually some argument in England between us three whether she should really be called Queen Camilla, because she's not really queen. But he's insisted everyone call her Queen Camilla. Whereas, you know, he had a wife before. Do you know who the wife of the king was before he married Camilla?
Dan.
Diana, yeah. And she could have been Queen Diana. But when they got divorced, they took away her title. And so then he married Camilla and he was like, oh, no, she's not going to be Her Royal Highness. But now she is Her Royal Highness. So a bit complicated there. And Ashley, what do you think of when you think of an English castle? Anything?
I think queen and princess and princess and prince.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah, we haven't mentioned them. Princes and princesses. Or that's how you... Oh, sorry. And princes and princesses in plural. Now, the most famous castle in London, in England, really, the most famous castle. Does anyone know what it's called? There's two which are really famous. Does anyone know the names of English castles? Two super, it was one in London and there's one near London.
Windsor.
Yes, well done. That's really good. Your knowledge is great.
But myself is a little bit weak. But my pronounce is a little weird.
No, I got it. Windsor. That was absolutely fine. It's a hard word to say. Windsor, because it's like two words. Windsor. And so we say Windsor. Mm-hmm. We don't usually say the D very strongly. You can do. But Windsor. Windsor, mm-hmm. Castle. Windsor Castle. And the other one is the Tower of London. The Tower of London is a castle. It's one of the oldest castles, in fact. It's but just to explain the history of castles in England, it's a Norman castle. Norman Castle. It's about 1,000 years old. 1,000 years old. It's a very interesting place as well. You can visit it. If you come to London, and also in the Tower of London is the crown jewels. And you know what the crown jewels are? Does anyone know what the crown jewels are? Why we use, what we do with the crown jewels? No? Well, we use the crown to crown the king at his coronation. And there are other pieces of special sort of jewellery. I mean, I can show you. Would you like to quickly see? I don't know if you've seen... let me just see if I can find this quickly. Yeah, this is the moment the king was crowned last year in May.
Royal scepter.
Can you all see my screen? Sorry. Can you all see my screen? Yeah. Yeah. This is the moment in the Westminster Abbey when this man is a priest. He's the Archbishop of Canterbury. And he put the crown on the head. Well, we'll see. I might speed it up a bit if it's too long.
Fire and justice. Rod of equity and mercy, a symbol of covenant and peace. May the Spirit of the Lord who anointed Jesus at his baptism so anoint you this day that you might exercise authority with wisdom and direct your counsels with grace, that by your service and ministry to all your people, justice and mercy may be seen in all the earth. Sacred anointing is done. Presentation of regalia complete. The moment of crowning has arrived. In the chair of St. Edward, with the crown of St. Edward.
I'll just quickly tell you, this crown is very heavy. It's really heavy. It's made of solid gold, and the stones are very heavy, and it's also very old. And they have to put the fur around the outside is, I've just recently discovered, it's called the cap of maintenance. And they had to resize the crown. And you'll see.
King Charles III. King of kings and Lord of lords, bless, we beseech thee, this crown. And so sanctify thy servant Charles, upon whose head this day thou dost place it for a sign of royal majesty, that he may be crowned with thy gracious favor and filled with abundant grace and all princely virtues. Through him who liveth and reigneth supreme over all things, one God, world without end. Amen. God save the king. Just quickly tell you, we won't watch too much. It's very interesting. You can watch this on YouTube. In this stick, it's called the scepter. It's a great word. Holmes. Oh, it's got so big. Let's make that.
sorry, scepter. Should fit an E. The scepter. In this scepter is the biggest diamond in the world. The purest, biggest diamond in the world. This big thing here, and it's quite big. It's about this big. It's the biggest, purest diamond that's ever been found. And it's called the Cullinan diamond. And it was found in South Africa. And it was put into the scepter about 100 years ago. It is the world's most valuable diamond. But it can't be sold. It's owned by England. And the crown dates back about 500 years. But it is very heavy. And that's why they had to keep pushing it on his head, because in a moment he gets up and walks, and it would be terrible if he started to walk and the hat fell off, you know. So you'll see. I don't know if we can see him walking. He has to carry quite a lot. Look. So it has to be quite sure that that crown is on. So let me show you some castles. And I think this is a short video on castles in England. There are many, many castles in England, many, and many in Scotland and Wales. And if you come to England, you can visit them. And some are so beautiful. And they're really exciting. I might show you a specific one in a minute, but have a look at this, and then I can stop, and you can ask questions if you like.
It's really hard not to fall in love with castles.
The views, you can stand there and you can watch them for hours. Iconic things like the arrow slits and the walls are things we always associate with castles.
I like the cannons.
Cannons!
Bang!
Blow down the walls.
Castles are places where some of the most important historic events in our country's history took place.
Love their power, their status, the people they've had living within them.
Brings history to life again.
This has been here for hundreds of years. Imagining what these walls could tell you if only they could speak. No castle is the same. Every castle you go to has its own unique attributes.
There's always an activity on.
One of our particular favourites is the jazz. It's absolutely thrilling.
It's something that you remember for a long time.
There's lots of space to play.
It's a great day out for the family and a chance to learn something about our history at the same time. There's nothing quite like unlocking the gate in the morning, walking up and thinking, wow, I work in a castle.
Castles are inspiring places with amazing stories to tell. They need constant attention to make sure that they're going to remain standing tall for future generations. As a charity, English Heritage relies on public support to carry out important conservation work so we can preserve our castles and their stories for generations to come. If you love castles as we do, then take your place in England's story by helping to give the nation's heritage a future. Donate today.
It looks good, doesn't it? They look beautiful. Often they are in an interesting landscape. I'll put that in. Set in a landscape. In countryside, you know the word countryside, or by the sea. I will show you if I can find it. This is Hever Castle. It's in near London. You can go on the train, and I often take my students there to see it. I'll show you two views. I'll show you the outside, then I'll show you the inside. Can you see my screen? Yeah. I'm just going to stop it there. Two questions I have. Does anyone know the name of this? What this is? It's a very English thing to have at a castle. It's made of it's alive. It's made of hedging. It's made of plants. Anyone know the name? Nope. It's called a maze. Maze. I'll stop sharing. Oh, let me just go smaller again. Hang on. It's called a maze. A maze. In other countries, you might call it, you could call it a labyrinth. But it's not. It's a hedge maze. And you can get lost in it. You can actually get lost in it. Hedge maze. And then also, does anyone know what this is around the castle? Can you see what that is? What is it?
Water.
It is water. And the reason it has water around the castle, it's not flooded. It's a protection because in the past, if anyone tried to get to the castle, they would have to go across the water. And then people would fire guns and arrows from these holes. And they would be able to shoot the people coming across the water. And this has a very specific word named to it, and it's called a moat. It's a moat. But I want to show you some footage inside the castle, if I can find it. It's amazing inside. It's very beautiful inside. It was restored in the early 20th century by a very rich American.
Hever Castle is opening these iconic original doors like never before. We are so excited to invite you to come inside Hever Castle and to explore this historic property from the comfort of your home. We will show you parts of the castle that have never been opened to the public before, take you into the heart of the castle archive, to explore the treasures that lay inside. And we will allow you to have close-up access to some of the priceless objects that are harder to see in person. You will have exclusive access to the expertise of our historians, curator, head gardener, and castle stewards, who will all guide you through the centuries of history that Hever holds. Depending on which tier you choose, you can also enjoy a monthly podcast, guest lectures, regular articles about Hever's history, documentary videos, as well as exclusive photography of the award-winning site. This online subscription is the perfect accompaniment to your visit to the castle and will also give unprecedented access to those of you who cannot make a visit in person. Inside Hever Castle would also make the perfect gift for a loved one who enjoys history, architecture, award-winning gardens, and all things Anne Boleyn. So join us.
So it's a beautiful castle, and it's in the countryside. There was a lady he mentioned. Anne Boleyn, and this is a portrait of her, if I can just find it. Now, do you know who this lady was? Does anyone know their English history? She was a queen. She was a queen. And she was one of our most famous queens. And something happened to her when she was still young. Does anyone know? No? No, she died when she was young, but she didn't die in a natural way. Does anyone know what happened or who she was married to? She was married to a very famous king. The most famous king, in a way, that most people in England will have heard of. Our most famous king. Any idea who the king was?
Henry.
Yes. What's the number? Henry VIII. Yes. Well done. Well done. And we tend to write it like, that. Henry VIII. He was Henry VIII. He had six wives. Six wives. And there's a poem. There's a phrase you can use to remember what happened to the six wives. Divorced, beheaded, died. divorce, beheaded, survived. His first wife, he was married to for a long time. He divorced her. And in divorcing her, he created the Church of England away from Rome. His second wife, and the reason he divorced his first wife, was Anne Boleyn. And she lived in this castle. When she was a child, she lived in Hever Castle. It was her childhood home. And she had a daughter, who went on to become a very, very famous daughter. Elizabeth the First. Their daughter was Elizabeth the First. But then she had some more pregnancies, but unfortunately the children died. And after 3 years of marriage, the king was getting older and had no son, wanted a son. And so he got rid of her. They made up a story about her, and she was arrested and she was executed. Now, do you know what happened to her? Does anyone know how she died? Yeah, I think Sunny just did it. Yeah, basically, Sunny just did the action. She went like this. Her husband had her head cut off. And we call that beheading. A bit gruesome. Beheading. She was beheaded. Very quickly. And she was beheaded in the Tower of London. I will try and show you. We haven't done the poem today, but I think this is interesting because we're talking about castles. Let me show you if I can find it. Yeah, we'll watch this. Basically, she was arrested and she was taken to the Tower of London and she was questioned because they said she'd been having an affair with other men while she was married to the king. It's likely not true, but she was very, very strong and she said, you know, I have not done this. But they managed to make evidence against her. They found men who they tortured. And so they committed her to death. The only thing they allowed her to choose was the man who cut off her head came from France and was very skilled because, and this is a bit gruesome, and I know it's late for you there, when you cut off someone's head, if you use an axe, it can go wrong. So she asked for a special swordsman to come from France. And she chose someone who could cut off her head with one sweep, which he did. Because there's other stories of other people being beheaded with axes and they, you know. But this is the scene from a TV drama about her. It's played by a very good actress. And it's really very good. So I think that we'll get her speech as well, hopefully.
Stop.
Oh, so we've got an advert, apologies.
Yogurt from every last inch of lid, but you can't. All the kids think. Perhaps they'll draw pictures of me and show their parents.
Yeah, love every bit.
It happened in the morning, very early in the morning. And it was a very grey day. That's why you can't see it. It was a very grey day. in the Tower of London.
I am competitor. According to the law, and by the law, I am judged to die.
You can't hear. And therefore, I think you speak up for a last word.
I am come hither to accuse no man, nor to speak anything of that law of I am accused and condemned to die. But I pray God save the king and send him long to reign over you. For gentler, more merciful prince was there never. And to me was he ever good, a gentle, and a sovereign lord. And if any person will meddle of my cause, I require them to judge best. And thus I take my leave of the world, and of you all. And I heartily desire you all to pray for me. Lord, have mercy on my soul. To God, I commend my soul.
Do not want men to handle her.
It's a little late for that.
This is the actress who played her. She's a very amazing English actress. Very good, actually. This is from a whole film called Wolf Hall. It's a book that's about that period. It's a very interesting book to read, and the television series is very good. What many people don't know was that the king was already having an affair with his next, the next woman he wanted to marry, and he married the next queen after, I think, 2 days after he cut the head, he married his next queen, a lady called Jane Seymour. And she got pregnant and she had a son. And so he had a prince, except she died in childbirth. She died giving birth to the child. So he killed his wife to get another queen who had a pregnancy, who gave him a son. And because of the time, the son was born, but she died in pregnancy. So then he had to marry again. And the fourth wife, he never met her because she was from another country. And someone had painted a portrait of her. And he thought she was very beautiful. So he said, yes, yes, I will marry her. She came to England, but a bit like a selfie with filters, it was not a true picture. So he met her and he was like, you know, like, who's this? And also she was like, who's that? Because
you are liar.
He was like young and handsome. He wasn't. He'd been young and handsome, but he was about 40. He got fat and old. And so they got married, and then instantly he divorced her. He did not live with her for a year, and they had no children. He didn't kill her. He just said, oh, no, I cannot be married to you. You are like my sister. And she went to live in a castle in England by herself. And she was happy. She was very happy not to be married to him. And then his fifth wife, another young girl, it was a mistake. She was young and she was very flirtatious. And he married her, and she did have an affair very quickly because he was a horrible, ugly looking old man by this time. And he also beheaded her. And then his sixth wife, he was old, and he married someone whose husband, in fact, her first husband had died, and she was an older lady. And she stayed with him until he died. And she was called Catherine Parr. But the story of the six wives of Henry VIII is actually a very interesting story. But the most poignant story is of Anne Boleyn, because she did nothing wrong, really. And also she was a very talented, intelligent, brilliant woman. And so she died. But her daughter became this amazing woman. I'll try and get it actually. Let me just find it. Let me just go onto YouTube. Wolf Hall's worth watching. It's a very good series. Very, very good. Very good series. I'm just going to stop this. Let me just... see what we get. Her daughter became this amazing woman. And I don't know if I can show you. There's a clip. Yeah. And she had a tough time becoming queen because her brother, the son of the third wife, became king first. And he did not live a long time. He was still young when he died. Her sister became queen, and her sister was a Catholic and very, very religious. And her mother had been divorced by Henry to marry Anne. So the sisters were like this against each other a bit. But the first sister was queen, so she could have had the younger sister killed. But she survived, and she became one of England's greatest queens. I mean, literally one of the greatest, greatest queens ever in England. This is the trailer. I think it's the first trailer. Let me have a look. We'll watch. I think this is the official trailer.
That will sweep away your pride.
Let me just, this is it actually, I think. a very good film. This is Kate Blanchett. I recommend it if you, she's amazing.
For the love of God, son, we need your kingdom to a heretic.
The queen is dead. Long live the queen.
You have inherited a most powerless and degenerate state, and is weaker than I have ever known. Apart from abroad, here at home, there are those who wish your majesty ill. We'll be damned for this. And I pray God, your wretched soul will burn in hell.
My father would not have made such a mistake. I have been proved unfit to rule. But that's what you think.
From this moment, I am going to follow my own opinion.
For God's sake, you are still my Elizabeth.
I have not said Elizabeth. I am no man's Elizabeth.
And just to show you, I know we've gone on a bit longer today. This I think this is one of the best portraits.
In my view, this is one of the most important portraits of Elizabeth I. And that's because we're fairly sure it must be painted directly from the life. And I think there's something incredibly exciting to think that Elizabeth I herself is standing in front of this very piece of wood. It's one of the few portraits of Elizabeth that you get a real sense of the person, the physical presence of the person. It shows Elizabeth I in her early 40s, and I think the likeness is just incredibly carefully observed and very, very beautifully painted.
So she became queen. She became perhaps our greatest queen. And also she lived for a long time as queen. And the story of her life is fascinating. So the daughter of Anne Boleyn, even though Anne Boleyn lost her head, her daughter went on to become one of the greatest queens in England. And the story of her life is very interesting, Elizabeth, very mysterious as well. She was the only monarch never to marry, She never married anyone. She said, I am married to England, which is a very interesting, because she did not want any man to control her. Because she knew if she got married, she would lose some of her power as queen to another man. There's other reasons and lots of legends and rumors about her as well. Because also, it sounds crazy, this was almost 500 years ago now, over 400 years ago. She controlled her image, amazingly, as a woman. She controlled her image. People couldn't just paint a picture of her. What they had to do, and I'm very interested in this from history, they created a shape of outline of her face and eyes and nose and mouth. and whoever painted a portrait of her had to stay within that shape. And so she always looked young. She never looked old in her photographs. Very interesting. She controlled, it was like a treasonous act to paint a picture of the Queen as old. So she was known as, I'll just put it actually, she was known as, she was known as Gloriana. Almost like a goddess. It's very interesting. Almost like a goddess.
We know very little about who painted this portrait or indeed who commissioned it. But what we do know from looking very carefully at the surface of this painting is that it was painted by a really talented artist and probably a Netherlandish emigre, someone that's here probably for a quite short period of time for a specific commission. What we know when we look really closely at the surface of this picture is that the artist is working in a very energetic way right from the outset, and that you have a sense that the artist is developing the composition as they're going along. They're not transferring a very direct, already worked out pattern. They're looking at how the composition might evolve. And you've got some very energetic marks in the underdrawing, particularly around the fan and the hands, which change position over time. The way that the artist is managing the paint is quite different from the way that English painters work as well, because they're working directly wet in wet. And that means that all of the paint is wet when they're manipulating it, different colours. And English artists don't usually work in that way. They put one layer on and they let that dry, and then they put another layer on. So that this is a very talented, energetic artist who's able to really up for the challenge of painting.
Her face is also very powerful, isn't it? Can you see that? Her look is very, she's very, very powerful. And she kept her image very remote. She, as she got older, she wore wigs. She wore red wigs. She had red hair. Her face was always very white. They used dangerous makeup, in fact, in those days, lead makeup. But you can tell how what presence she has. And the many portraits are very interesting. It's worth looking. So I've talked too much today, I realized. I'm gonna stop sharing. But I hope you found that interesting today. I know it was a bit gruesome, apologies, with the beheading of Anne Boleyn, but I mean, it was a fact, it happened, you know. And if you go to the castle I showed you, Hever, it was her childhood home where she grew up with her sisters and brothers. So, I mean, it is very interesting. Sorry, let me just have some water. Well, thank you for coming today, everyone. And Ashley, lovely to meet you. I hope you enjoyed the lesson. And
yeah, thank you.
No, a pleasure. Lovely to meet you. And thank you, Sunny and Zoe, as always. Very good to see you. And I hope Elizabeth I will inspire you to be strong, independent women. You know, I have three sisters and they are all strong, independent women, and I support them. So I wish you well in your studies, and Sunny, don't worry about your exam. I will see you next week, hopefully. So take care for now. Bye for now. Bye. Bye.